cover crops and the sustainable farming practices work in a row crop farming system. It's maybe a little more challenging in the fact that I don't have something that's going to eat those and convert them to pounds of beef. I don't have something I can sell to a consumer in this is a pound of beef that was raised from these acres. What I need are bushels of corn, bushels of soybeans, or some sort of crop, or a reduction in inputs that yields the same. So I'm selling pounds of grain, not pounds of beef. And how do we do that? And it wasn't until the last few years that we really started trying to measure that, where this was this system, this was this system, let's compare it. We've always had the capability of harvesting the data. Now the capability is there to analyze this data. Let's see what difference there are and let's put some figures to it. Let's quantify that data because, yeah, it looks better, it looks good, but if you can't measure it, how can you really see? And what we found is comparing strip till to conventional till, we were having way less expense and we actually started yielding more. So that was an easy one. The no-till, even farther less expense. On a whole field average, you'd maybe have a couple bushels an acre lower yield. Now, is that the no-till? Is that the weather? Is that, you know, fertility? There's all sorts of variables. The last few wet springs, I'll almost guarantee you we were better off not working that wet soil and no-tilling it than if we would have ran a field cultivator and worked wet soil. We've done that in the past. I know that doesn't work. So that has proven to be profitable. We're still working on that. The cover crops has really been the fun thing in the last few years to really analyze these regions of, okay, after sweet corn, we planted a cover crop containing cereal rye. In 2018, that cereal rye came back in the spring and we planted soybeans just to see the yield difference. Same soybean variety, rye, no rye. And we'd seen that in 17 and in 16 too, but we just didn't have the tools to measure it, to quantify it. So now creating those regions and breaking it apart, it's really fun to see and seeing the difference. All of our soybean varieties are all breeder names because they're all for seed, but the one variety, it's a 1.9 maturity, went 55.1, and in the region, it was 6 bushels better where I had the rye. And being able to break it down, that was in 2018. 6 bushels better on that soybean variety. 2019 corn. Got done with the soybeans, strip-tilled the field like our normal practice. Didn't do anything different. The whole field was strip-tilled. Where there was no rye, 196.40, it's a corn hybrid, 192. Where there was rye, it was from fall of 2017, same hybrid, 217. So 17 plus 8 is 25 bushels difference. We didn't do anything different in the fall of 18. Where there was rye, 2 years before, we had 25 bushels more of corn, and it's side by side. And if you look at the yield map, there's dark green and light green. I mean, just boom, there's the line. So using the technology to put some hard numbers to just the cereal rye cover crop, and the profitability is there, the soil health benefits are bonus. It really, but then, and that's in the first year. We'll call that the first year that the soil health are bonus, but the second year, without doing it, we're seeing a 25 bushel yield increase. So the soil health benefits are making that. It wasn't the cover crop we seeded the fall before. It's what that cover crop did 2 years ago that now 25 bushels. Everybody would love to have an extra 25 bushels. And our soil stayed in place. You know, when we had the cover crop, it added habitat for wildlife. There's pheasant nests out there. I've watched them when I'm planting, the pheasants moving around. I've driven around duck nests just because I'll see the hen mallard fly up and there's the nest and I lift up and go down. So it's providing a whole lot more benefit than just a cover crop. So it's really fun to be able to put the numbers to what we're seeing with the cover crops and really put some dollar amounts to it. I know what the strip till does, and I was trying to remember what we were getting, you know, back when we did full width tillage. 12 row strip till bar, 320 horse front wheel assist tractor, pulling about 6.5 to 7 miles an hour. Depends on how much fertilizer I'm trying to blow out and that kind of dictates speed. But I'm covering about 20 to 23 acres an hour, depending on speed. I'm burning about 15 gallons of fuel an hour. So that's somewhere around that 0.6 to 0.7 gallons of fuel per acre. And that's it. That's the fall tillage. That's considered your fall tillage and your spring tillage and your fertilizer application. Chisel plowing, same tractor. We have a 27-foot chisel. 15 gallons of fuel an hour, roughly. We're pulling a 15 acres an hour. That's at 1 gallon an acre. That's on a pretty fuel-efficient tractor. That was that same front wheel assist. That one has a nice tractor management feature where it will adjust your RPMs based on workload. So if you're going down a hill, it throttles back, but you maintain the same speed as you go up the hill. Maintains your speed by shifting the transmission and giving it more RPMs. No fertilizer application. Yeah, I'm not driving the fertilizer spreader, but somebody is, and I'm paying for that fuel. Disc ripping, we were on the four-wheel drive, we were using about 23 gallons of fuel an hour, and we were doing about 15 acres an hour. So that's after corn. If you were in the chisel plow, spring field cultivator system, most people were in the fall disc ripping too. That was using about 1.5 gallons an acre. That's just the fall tillage part. The field cultivator was about 1 gallon per acre for fuel usage with the field cultivator. So when we talk about seed bed preparation before corn, strip till, 0.65 to 0.75 gallons of fuel per acre. Chisel plow, field cultivator, one for chisel plow, one for field cultivator, you're at 2. Less than half of the fuel for the strip till versus the conventional tillage system. That's just the fuel. Let's look at time, because my time is worth something, and I bought a field cultivator in 08. I've probably spent 10 hours in it myself. My grandfather, who is 92, he's a tillage guy. That's what his job was. He did all the fall tillage. He's not gonna be around forever. Finding good help is hard. Finding a good operator is even harder. How are we gonna do this as he can do less and less, since strip till was a big thing for us, because I don't have to have somebody in the spring do that. So conventional tillage, let's look at the time. We're saying chisel plow and field cultivator at 15 acres per hour on a 1,000-acre farm, you know, just to put a number to it. You're looking at 66.67 hours for chisel plowing. That's at 15 acres an hour. That doesn't include the prep and all of that stuff, travel. But then you're going to run a field cultivator at 25 acres an hour. You're at 40 hours. So to do all the field prep for 1,000 acres of corn, you're at 106 hours. So a week and a half. And you got to either do it yourself or hire somebody to do that. Time for the strip till for 100 acres an hour at 20 acres an hour is 50 hours. Half the time, you're done. You're done in half the time. So if you had to hire somebody or find somebody to do it or do it yourself, I can manage 50 hours of my time in the fall. I can't manage 106 hours between fall and spring and harvest and plant and spray in the spring and do all of that. So it's so much more than just fuel, it's time too. And that right there is a big deal. Now it's a difference, it's a change in operator capabilities, because the technology and understanding where I make the strips is where I'm gonna plant. So how does this field have to be, and being able to get out and make some adjustments. So it is a shift in management, but if you have the right operators, it's way more fuel efficient, way more time efficient. So when you talk about the quality of life of a farmer using sustainable farming practices, I think there's a lot of good qualities. We save time by not having to make these extra passes. Then I've saved time by not having to repair all these other pieces of equipment. And having that time can be spent elsewhere. So that can either be spent with your family, which is an important thing for me with two young girls and a wife, and being able to say, yeah, I can come home and grill tonight, or yeah, we can go to the pool like last night. yeah, we can go do this. Having the time to do that and not having to make these extra passes is really valuable to me. The quality of life of knowing that I'm doing something that's benefiting our fields, our environment, our community, by making sure everything that comes off this field, whether it's the grain itself or the water that leaves this field or anything like that, has been thought about and treated in the best care it could be. It gives me a sense of pride to know that I'm doing this the best I can with other things in mind other than yield only. It's rewarding to know that these practices are benefiting things other than just me. And, you know, it's kind of fun to, you know, with two young girls and a wife that's not from the farm, to explain what we're doing to her and to them, the girls, and while they ask questions, why do you do it? Why don't you do this? And explain it. And it's helping them learn that, hey, there's different ways to do things. And I don't badmouth the neighbors for how they farm, and that's fine. They can do what they want on their side of the fence. And we used to do it that way too. And it's no right or wrong. So I think it's opening their eyes to, you know, there's lots of ways to do things. So it's fun to do things different. It's fun to see them have a father that says, I don't have to do what everybody else does.